Good evening, everyone. Let's prepare our hearts and worship the Lord this evening. Thank you for the cross, the mighty cross, that God Himself should die for such as us. And every day we're changed into Your image more and more. Yes, by the cross we've truly been transformed. We're so
to the cross. It was such an ugly and brutal symbol in the eyes of the world. But in us, what we see is a symbol of life and redemption and salvation and cleansing and hope. And so tonight, let us be reminded again what the cross means for us. And let us be reminded once again what God has done for us on that cross. And just remember His love for us. And once again, let us come with grateful heart. Thank you, Jesus.
It's your blood that cleanses me. It's your blood that gives me life. And it's your blood that took my place in redeeming sacrifice, washes me.
Thank the Lord for His sacrifice for us. Just in your own way, just give praise and give thanks to the Lord. God, we thank you. God, we thank you for the blood that you shed, for the suffering that you went through. Just because you loved us, that you took our place. It should have been our place on the cross. But Lord, by your grace and your mercy and your great love for us, and we thank you, God, for your sacrifice. Thank you, Jesus.
My cross you bore, so I could live.
Worthy, 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 worthy.
is your name.
Just the voices.
Worthy is your name, Jesus. You deserve the praise. Worthy is your name. Worthy is your name, Jesus. You deserve the praise. Worthy is your name.
Sing worthy.
Worthy is your name, Jesus. You deserve the praise. Worthy is your name. Worthy is your name.
Oh, yes, Lord.
Jesus.
Worthy, O God.
You deserve the praise. Worthy is your name.
Come on, church, right wherever you are, right across this hall, lift your hands up to the Lord. Lift your hands up, and in your own way, begin to sing worthy. Just declare worthy, worthy, King of kings and Lord of lords. Oh, you deserve the praise. Come on, do not be silent. From the front to the back, left to the right. Come on, do not be silent. Lift your voice and declare, worthy Lord, worthy God. For just a brief moment, come on, declare, worthy, worthy, worthy is the King of kings and the Lord of lords. Worthy is the Lamb that was slain. The sacrifice, Jesus, spotless, sinless, He became our substitute. Oh, worthy God, worthy, oh Lord, worthy, Lord. Come on, declare it, declare it. Here, it is good to see so many of us gathered in the house of the Lord, and we are here to worship the Lord. We are here to worship Him, to adore Him. Just say, Lord, I love You for all that You've done, for all that You can do, for all that You will do, oh God. You Lord, we love You Lord, we love You Lord. Shida da 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 Maria na la masandai. Now very quickly, before we turn the order of the service, and I just sense the presence of God just so strong in our midst. Now if there's a need in our midst, if you have a need, and I know there are many needs.
I remember that lady in the midst of the crowd that was thronging Jesus. People were brushing past Jesus. But there was one lady who just said, "If I could just touch the hem of his garment, I will be healed." You know, right now, can I encourage you in the midst of the crowd? Just reach out to the Lord and say, "Lord, I need a touch." Some need healing. Some need an encounter. Some are going through situations that only the Lord can deliver you. There are some who just, the doctors have said, only a miracle. Just a moment. Just reach out to the Lord, right where you are. You and the Lord. And say, "Father, Father, you did it at Calvary 2,000 years ago. You have been doing it countless times. And right now, Lord, Jesus, we need a miracle. We need an encounter. As to our faith, come on, as to your faith. As to your faith, you say, Lord, I surrender this into your hands and I believe. I believe as you hear, I receive from you. I receive, Lord, in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, come on, in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Father, I thank you for your presence. I thank you for the reality of your word. And I thank you, Lord, that you give good gifts to your children. As we ask of you in faith, Lord, you give good gifts, O God. And we receive all that our hearts have brought before you, O God. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father, for your presence. Continue to minister. Minister, Lord, to your people. We commit ourselves into your hands in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you, church. Please take a seat. Thank you, worship team, for leading us. Isn't it wonderful to be back in the house of the Lord? Okay, five of us. Come on. Isn't it good to be back in the house of the Lord? Amen. Let me just tell you one thing. You know, many of you were sitting here, and just before Pastor opened the service, and you were sitting here, and many of you were wondering, like, why are... Hello? Testing. 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 Okay. Yep. We've been having a lot of that. Okay. We're wondering, why aren't we starting yet? Why aren't we starting yet? There was a lot of technicalities that had to be sorted through. So give the media team a hand for all, you know. It's like you're seeing things on the surface very smooth, but there's a lot of background movement happening. So remember the media team. Remember that there are many components to get our service running. Amen? All right. Welcome to GD Klang, and if you are here, you know that we are here to celebrate our Good Friday service. And someone asked this question, what's so good about Good Friday? I mean, isn't this the day that we remember that Jesus was crucified? He was crucified. What's so good about it? We know that 3 days after he crucified, what happened? What happened? Some of you are not sure. It's in your Bible. 3 days after he was crucified, he rose again. Maybe it's your mask. I can't hear you very clearly. He rose again. Amen? So we celebrate a risen Savior. And that's what I believe for each and every one of our lives. So welcome. Welcome to GD Klang. Now, if there are anybody who is here for the very first time, if you are here for the very first time, you've not joined us for any of our services, and you are here, we want to welcome you. So if you happen to be here, can I ask you to stand? If you're here in our hall, can I ask you to stand right where you are? Anyone here? I don't want to mess you up. Anybody? Yes. Yes. Thank you. Sister Christina, right? Christina, yeah. Okay, welcome you. And if you're online, thank you. You may be seated. If you're online, please... scan our QR code, and fill in your details. We want to get in touch with you to just welcome you and introduce you to GD Klang. Can we do that? Okay. So if you're online and you're visiting with us, please connect with us in that way. All right. Let's get ready to give our offering this evening. Very quickly, we have worshiped the Lord. just want to give us an opportunity to give towards the Lord. Whether it's your tithe, your mission promise, or your love gifts. You know, as we come before the Lord, we come not with empty hands, but we come with hearts that are appreciative, and we come to bring what our hearts have determined to give. There are collection boxes at the entrance, if that's how you want to give, or you can scan the code, or via bank transfer. But let's commit our giving. Father, we thank you this evening once again. Lord, you are real. You are alive. And you are a loving God. So we just want to thank you for calling us according to your name, O God. And this evening, as we have worshipped you with our songs, with our singing, we want to worship you with a portion of what you have blessed us. I ask, O God, that Lord, you will bless every giver, every cheerful giver, as we give, as our hearts have determined, O God. May you bless both the gift and the giver, O God, that we will never, we know, Lord, that we will never outgive you. But Lord, our hearts recognize that we love you, and that's why we give towards you. So we ask that this gift that we bring to your house will be used for the furtherance of your kingdom. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Thank you for giving to the house of the Lord. Very quickly, I just want to give you a couple of announcements. One, prayer meeting. Every Tuesday, we have our prayer meeting online. Every Tuesday. And we come together over Zoom. There's worship. There's even a sharing of the Word of God. And it's a time of prayer. Okay? So, if you are not aware, you can connect with one of the life group leaders, one of the pastors. We will connect you to our prayer meeting. And we look forward to having different ones engage with us in our prayer meetings. Okay? Okay, a couple more announcements. Our children's ministry and our Royal Rangers services are resuming on site, in person. Just like how the adults have started last Sunday, the children's ministry and the Royal Rangers will resume next Sunday. Next Sunday. So if you have children, if you have nieces, nephews, neighbors that you would like to connect with our Royal Rangers or our children's ministry, please take note. Next Sunday, they will be resuming in person. Please contact the relevant people or the church office if you have any more questions. Also, our outreach at GT Setia Alam. GT Setia Alam, they begin their in-person services. That means their physical services. They begin this Sunday. This Sunday, they begin. And if you have any more questions on this, you can see or talk to Pastor Roy. Okay? All our announcements, all our information, you can get hold of it on our website, gtclang.com/updates. Now, if you usually we say we register for services, okay? We ask you to register for our services. So if you need any help for registration of the services, you can contact one of us and we will help you to get registered. This is so that we make sure that you have a seat in the house, you know? Every Sunday, we are noticing more and more people coming back, getting comfortable, and we're looking forward to the day where the gaps will be closer and the seats will be fuller. Amen? Today, the mask is not helping us to communicate. Amen? Amen. Are we ready for the Word of God this morning, this evening? Are we ready for the Word of God? Let's put our hands to welcome our main pastor as he comes to bring us the Word of God.
Good evening, church. Come on, good evening. You know, I just want to say this. You know, it's just so glad to be here in God's house. I don't know how to put it. I mean, while it's convenient to worship Him online, and of course, I know, you know, it's during the MCO, we really had no choice. But, you know, just to come to the house of the Lord and to be gathered here together with all the brothers and sisters, with all our brothers and sisters, and just worshiping God. I mean, there is nothing like that. There's nothing like that. The experience is, I don't know how to say it. You have to come to experience it. You have to be here to experience it. So I want to encourage you, please come. Make your way on Sunday to our service. And I believe that the Lord will just bless you. And now, nothing wrong with meeting if you are at home and you can't come. Nothing wrong with that. But I want to encourage you, when the opportunity arises and when you can, come and join us on site. Come and join us on site. Now, today is Good Friday. How many of you don't know that? I'm sure all of us know today is Good Friday. And I have a message I believe that the Lord placed in my heart. And I would just like to share it with us tonight. You know, friends, more than 2,000 years ago, our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ went to the cross on our behalf. Now, we all know that. The Bible tells us in the book of Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2, and this is what Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2 says, "For the joy set before him, he endured the cross." It is talking about Jesus. The Bible tells us that because of the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. And friends, do you know the reason why Jesus went to the cross was because of the joy that was set before him? And you know who is this joy that was set before him? Do you know? Don't look as if like, come on, church, you got to work with me tonight. Who was the joy that was set before him? What was this? What is this joy? You and me. The joy of the, this is what he, you know what Jesus meant? He went to the cross because of you and me. The joy that was set before him, and he endured the cross. You know, he endured the cross, scorning its shame. And now he is sat down at the right hand of God. Friends, we are the joy. We are the joy that was set before him. He didn't leave us where we were in our sin. He didn't leave us where we were in our troubles. But he made a choice. He went to the cross for us. And because of you and me, he endured it, the Bible says, scorning its shame. And now at this point in time, he is seated at the right hand of God. Friends, why don't you just tell your neighbor, you are God's joy. Come on. Come on, you are God's joy. For the joy that was set before him. Friends, he saw us dying and drowning in our sins, but he loved us too much to let that happen, to let us remain where we were. And so he endured a cruel death, the Bible says, on the cross, so that he can save us. Now, this is why today is called Good Friday. This is what Good Friday is all about. This is why we call today good, because Jesus went to the cross for us and did something good for all of us. He saved us. And that is why the gospel is also called the good news. Today we can celebrate Good Friday. Although, you know, some people like what Pastor Nihal says, you know, what's so good about Good Friday? Isn't this the day that your Savior was crucified? We can call it good because it was actually us that was supposed to be on the cross. It was actually us that was supposed to be crucified. We can call it good because someone took our place for us. And friends, that person is Jesus. This evening, if you have your Bibles, why don't you turn with me to the book of Matthew? The book of Matthew. I want to bring us back just before, what happened on Good Friday. The Sunday that we all know as Palm Sunday. I want to bring us back to then because I want to show you something happened. Something happened in between that Sunday, that Palm Sunday, and Good Friday. In between those 4 or 5 days, something happened that changed the cheering. It started off with cheering. It started off with welcoming a hero, somehow like a hero on Sunday, on Palm Sunday, but something happened and something changed that on Friday it turned into jeer. You know what's jeering? Jeer. So friends, if you have your Bible, turn with me to the book of Matthew chapter 21. I want to read verses 1 to 11. 1 to 11. Matthew tells us in chapter 21, verse 1, he says, As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and once you find a donkey tied there with a colt by her, untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, tell him that the Lord needs them, and he will send them right away." And this, in verse 4 says, "This took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet." Verse 5, "Say to the daughters of Zion, see, your king comes to you, gentle and riding on a donkey, on a colt, a foal of a donkey." The disciples went and did as Jesus had instructed them, and they brought the donkey and the colt and placed their cloaks on them, and Jesus sat on them. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowd went ahead of him, and those that followed shouted, "Hosanna! Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he that comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest!" When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, "Who is this?" The crowds answered, "This is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee." The crowds answered, "This is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee." Shall we pray? Father, once again this evening, I just ask that you will help me and anoint me. That God, that even as I share your word, God, Lord, that it will all be about you and nothing about me. Father, tonight I want to give you all the glory because you deserve all the glory. Because you are, God, Lord, an awesome God. And Father, tonight, even as we have come here to worship you, Lord, I pray that every heart will be open, every ear be open to hear what the Holy Spirit is saying. God, I ask that you will strengthen me as well. Help me, dear God, Lord, that even as I deliver your message will find in the hearts of men a fertile ground that he will take root and he will grow and in due season bring forth much fruit of righteousness for your name's sake. I ask all this in Jesus' most mighty name. Amen. 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 The title of my sermon this evening is this: From Cheers to Jeers. From Cheers to Jeers. You have just read on Palm Sunday how they welcomed Jesus. Jesus came in riding on a donkey, a foal of a donkey, and was done to fulfill Scripture. Now, I want you to understand this. Jesus, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, chose to come into Jerusalem riding on a donkey. Can you imagine that, friends? If you were Jesus, I think there were many other animals we would choose. You know, many of the Roman emperors, when they come in triumphantly into the city, nobody is going to come in on sitting on a donkey. They'll be sitting either on a magnificent stallion, maybe on a, you know, I don't know, maybe on a huge elephant, maybe on a carriage, a chariot driven by I don't know how many horses. That would be the case for kings, from lords, someone great, someone you know that was so famous. But for Jesus, he chose a donkey. And he wrote in, this was to tell all of us friends, that Jesus, although he's the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, he comes in a humble attitude. Aren't we all glad for that? He came with a servant attitude. He came humbly. And we all could see that at the crowd, when they saw him coming in, what did they do? Some of them took off their clothes and laid on the road. Some cut branches and they were all saying, Hosanna, Hosanna to the Son of David. Hosanna basically meant, Jesus, save us, save us. They were saying, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he that comes in the name of the Lord. They were cheering him. They were giving him, you know, their best or best welcome possible. People were wondering, who is this person that deserves such a welcome? And then they say, this is Jesus of Nazareth, the prophet from Nazareth. But in just a few short days, on Good Friday, the cheers stopped. The cheers turned into jeering. It turned from welcoming a hero to now wanting to crucify him. So much so, you know what, friends, that when Pilate asked, whom shall I release? You know, at a point in time, there was a tradition. And in the custody was this guy by the name of Barabbas. Barabbas was a murderer, was a thief, was a robber. And Pilate says, you know, wanting to save Jesus, he did this because he wanted to save Jesus. He knew that Jesus was innocent. And so he made this opportunity and says, oh, who shall I release? Shall I release Barabbas or Jesus? But the crowd, I do not know for what some reason, the cheering stopped, the cheering changed into jeering. And they hated him so much to a point that they said, release to us Barabbas. Release a thief to us. Release this murderer to us. But crucify Jesus. What happened? I mean, the question that begs to be answered is this. What happened? Why did the masses so radically turn against him? How did the shouts of Hosanna on Sunday transform into the shouts of crucify him on Friday? How did the cheers turn into jeers? I believe there were some underlying issues that cause all this to happen. And I believe that if we look at the Jesus ministry from the time he came, his triumphant entry into Jerusalem on Palm Sunday, I believe the last 7 days are going up to Friday and then on Sunday, Resurrection Sunday, I believe if you see what Jesus was doing and what he was saying, we will get a clue why this cheering turn into jeer. Why this cheering turn into jeering? Let me suggest to you three reasons why I think the cheers turn into jeer, and they are this. The first thing is this. I have 3 points this evening. The first one, I believe, is the word compassion. Compassion. Jesus began to talk more and more about compassion. The next thing I notice is there's not only compassion, Jesus began to talk more and more about commitment. Commitment. And last but not least, I believe Jesus, in his last 7 days of ministry, began to talk more about the cross. And I believe it was for this reason, and I'm going to show you in a short while. It is for these 3 reasons I believe that the cheers turn into jeers. The first one, compassion. I believe that the cheers turn into jeers because Jesus dared to suggest that all people are worth dying for. Or can I say, all peoples are worth loving. Now, why do I say that? Now, look at what happened on Palm Sunday. In the following verses from Matthew chapter 21, verse 12 onwards, We see Jesus going into the temple. Yes or no? Look at your Bible. Look at Matthew 21. Come on, turn with me. Matthew 21. 21, verse 12. What does verse 12 say? And Jesus entered the temple area and drove out all who were buying and selling there. He overturned the tables of the money changers and the benches of those selling doves. It is written, he said, that my house will be called a house of prayer, but you are making it into a den of robbers. Immediately after his triumphant entry into Jerusalem, the first place he went to was to the temple. And lo and behold, what did he see? He saw all these things that were happening. There were buying and selling going on. Now, is there anything wrong? Well, some scholars suggest actually there's nothing wrong. But you know what happened was while they were buying and selling, they took up the outer courts that was supposed to be for the Gentiles. And not only that, you know, there were things when they were doing all this money exchange, there were cheating going on. And so some scholars suggest that it was because of all these things that were happening. And Jesus understood and he saw what was happening. And we all know what happened, right? He chased them out. He overturned the table. He chased all of them out. And he says this, my house will be called a house of prayer. He says, my house will be called a house of prayer. Friends, what he did was this. He invited the lame, the poor, the sick, the outcast of society and to come in to worship God in the temple. Because initially there was no place, but when he drove all these people out, there was now space and he invited all these people to come into the house of the Lord, into the temple. You know, friends, by bringing these people into the temple, it was his way of saying this. Everyone have an access to God, even the poor. Everyone have an access to God, even those of them who are not loved, who are not welcomed by society, so to speak. You see, the Jews always thought that initially salvation was only for them because they were the chosen people. But we know, as things began to unfold, we know God's plan was not just for the Jews. And we see when Jesus did that, he made a statement. He says, my house will be called a house of prayer for all nations. He made this statement. What he did was to say that, you know what? People deserve to be saved. No matter who they are, everyone deserves to have an access to God. Look at verse 14 onwards. He's on the way to the capital city, a poor blind beggar comes to him and he cries out. What did he say? Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me. And what was the response of the crowd? They rebuked him and told him what? Shut up. Shh, hey, don't talk so loud. Come on, Jesus is here. Don't disturb him. I mean, sometimes we have people like that, right? When their need is so great. Now, I'm all for order in a service. But sometimes when we come in, friends, there's a need that's so great. Sometimes we cry out to the Lord. I hope that we don't tell on that. Shh, don't talk so loud. Don't pray so loud in church. Jesus makes, they rebuke him and told him to shut up. Told this blind man, don't say so loud. Don't shout so loud. Look what happened in the temple court. Look what happened to this blind man. Jesus healed him. And what happened, we see, is this. The children, the Bible tells us, the children, when they saw all this, now come on, let's look at, turn with me to 14, verse 14. It says, the blind and the lame came to him at the temple. And what did he do? He healed them. But when the chief priests and teachers of the law saw the wonderful things he did, and the children shouting in the temple area, Hosanna to the Son of David. They were what? Indignant. Do you hear what the children are saying? They ask. Yes, Jesus replied. Have you never read from the lips of children and infants
you have ordained praise. And verse 17 says, and he left them and went out to the city of to Bethany, where he spent the night. Listen to me, church. Jesus began to talk about compassion for the lost. He began to talk about more and more about those of them who are underprivileged, those of them who are blind, those of them that need healing. And he began to talk about children. You know, sometimes back in those days, children were not counted, or children were, I don't know how to say it, but you know, back in those days, children were like not counted at all, you know. Or they were not taken notice of. And sometimes, you know, even in our society, we always do that. Sometimes in our children, we you know, when they want to say something, or we always say, shh, don't talk so much. But Jesus began to give notice to this group of people, began to tell, you know, and as he showed them, he healed the blind. And the children, you know, he tell the children were singing praises. He says, hey, don't you know, children, you know, it was ordained from the children's sleep to sing praises. Jesus was doing all this, and he began to tell the people and showing the people, you know what? We have to have compassion. We have to have compassion because everyone deserves an access to the Lord. The gospel is not an exclusive gospel. The gospel is not just for a select few. It's for everyone who needs him. Even the poor, especially the sick, even the children. Compassion. Jesus began to talk more and more about compassion. And sometimes, you know, friends, like I said, I know I read a story. And I believe it to be a true story. It says one day a pastor wanted to see how well his congregation would congregation would react. So what did he do was he went outside. He was not in church on that day, and he disguised himself to be a vagabond, to be a beggar. He put on all the dirty clothes. He smelled terrible. He kept his hair long, wasn't shaven, and all that. And he tried to come to church. And in his coming to church, he began to see how his members treated this beggar when he stepped into the church. My question to us today, this evening, is this. Jesus began to talk more and more about compassion, about the lost, about those people who are unloved. And many people are actually uncomfortable with that. Because why? We don't want to ruin our nice carpet. But I want to say this to you, friends. I hope that when a beggar comes to our doors, that we will give him the best seat in the house. That we will not shy away from him, but we will do everything in the best that we can to show him the love that Jesus has shown to us. Remember, we were once beggars. Yes. We were once lost in sin. We were once, you know, friends, in a bad position. We were under the slave, you know, of sin, under our habits, but Jesus set us free. And now that we are free, friends, I hope that, you know, we will be like what someone tells me, you know, be like a beggar telling another beggar where to get food. Jesus began to talk more and more about compassion. You see, friends, sometimes it makes us uncomfortable. But I pray that when there are people like that who comes through our doors, that we will not shy away. That someone comes in even with a broken jeans and torn shirt, long hair, tattoos all over, I pray that we will not shy away, but yet extend that hand to that person and welcome him to the house of the Lord. Because truly, this is the house of the Lord. This is going to be the house, this is the house of prayer unto all nations. Jesus began to talk more and more about compassion, and friends, I suspect because of that, many people were uncomfortable. The second thing I want to say is this. Jesus began to talk more and more about commitment. One reason why I also believe that the cheers turned to jeers is that Jesus began to talk more and more about commitment. Prior to Jesus, to this, Jesus' message has largely been about grace, been one of grace. When the 5,000 people were hungry, more than 5,000 were hungry, what did he do? He fed them. When they were sick, when they brought the sick to him, he healed them. When a woman was caught in adultery and was about to stone, Jesus came and rescued her. The message of his ministry was one of grace upon grace. But now, in the last week, running up to the cross, you know, friends, Jesus now began to talk more about commitment. Now, you see, the other side of the coin, you know, for us is this. Yes, on one side, grace, the message of grace. Yes, God loves us. Yes, he cares for us. But we need to understand that he saved us for a reason. Amen? He saved us for a reason. There is commitment involved. There is an obligation that is placed on us when we are saved. Look at verse 18. It talks about the fig tree. He says this. Early in the morning, as he was on his way back to the city, he was hungry. Seeing a fig tree by the road, he went up to eat, but found nothing on it except leaves. Then he said to it, "May you never bear fruits again." Immediately, the tree withered. Jesus saw a fig tree, and what was the fig tree was supposed to do? Supposed to bear fruits. And when it didn't bear fruits, he just says, "Okay, look, since you're not going to bear fruit, you're not going to bear fruit forever." What was Jesus talking about? He says, "Come on." He was telling the fig tree, "Where's your commitment to bear fruits? Where's your commitment to bear fruits? You are a fig tree. You're supposed to bear fruits." What about the next one? Look at verse 28. Go down, verse 28. It talks about the parable of the two sons. This is what do you think? There was a man who had two sons. He went out to the first and he said, "Son, go and work today in the vineyard." Verse 29 says, "I will not," he answered. But later he changed his mind. Some Bible says he repented and then he went. Then the father went to see the other son and he said the same thing. He answered, I will, sir. But he did not go. Which of the two did the father wanted? The first, they answered. Jesus said to them, "I tell you the truth." Listen here. He says, "I tell you the truth. The tax collectors and the prostitutes are entering the kingdom of heaven ahead of you." Jesus was saying, look, come on. Which of these two sons? The first one who said that he will go and then didn't go? Or the other one who says that he didn't want to go? Later repented and went. You see, a son has commitments. The first one said that, yes, he will go, but he did not keep his commitment. He didn't go. Now, the second one, of course, he says, "No, I didn't want to go," but later on remembered, was reminded of his commitment. He repented that as a son, he should do what he needed to do, and he went. Jesus was talking more and more about commitment. The other side of the coin, as I mentioned to you, yes, one side is grace. Yes, God loves us, and I got no issues with that. But we must take it, understand that with this comes obligation, with this comes commitment. We are saved to be a blessing. And sometimes I feel that it is because of this, when we talk about commitment, people don't like it. That's why I believe sometimes the cheer turn into jeering, because Jesus began down, instead of talking about grace, everybody loves to hear about grace. But when time comes to take responsibility, when time comes to make a commitment, nobody wants to. I suspect that was one of the reasons why the cheering turned into jeering. Jesus began to talk more and more about commitment. You see, sometimes I'm also sad that, you know, sometimes commitment is also missing in the church. We don't mind the grace part, like I said. But when time comes to make a commitment, we say no. It's easy to follow Jesus when it's all nice and rosy. But when Jesus tells us to pick up our cross and deny ourselves the responsibility, the commitment, we find it too difficult. That's why the Bible tells us don't make converts. Don't just make converts. The Bible tells us to do what? Come on, everybody. You should know this by now. The theme of our church tells us to do what? Make disciples. Not just converts, but disciples. And friends, sometimes discipleship, I'm not saying sometimes, discipleship is hard because it will cost us something. It will cost us our commitment. And I suspect not many are willing to pay that price. Friends, commitment means that after the shouts of Hosanna on Palm Sunday, we walk to Golgotha carrying his cross of suffering together with Jesus. Let me repeat that. Commitment means that after the shouts of Hosanna on Palm Sunday, we now walk to Golgotha carrying his cross of suffering together with Jesus. The cheers turn to jeers when Jesus begin to speak about commitment. When he begin to speak about compassion, that the kingdom of God is for everyone, not just the elite, not just the chosen, not just the rich, but also for the poor, for those of them who are sick, for those of them who are blind, even for children. Jesus began to talk about compassion. He began to talk more about commitment, more and more about commitment, telling us that yes, you are saved. Yes, he message of grace. But he says with this comes a responsibility, and all of us Christians need to mature. Come on, tell your neighbor, mature. Some of us not mature. Tell your neighbor, come on, like you mean it, mature. We need to mature. Because it requires commitment. How many of you like to be in a relationship for a long time without any commitment? Maybe there are some of us here, but I don't know. But I don't know about you, but me, I would love to be, I don't want to be in a relationship that is going nowhere. I want to be in a relationship that has a commitment, both from me and from the other side, the other party. Jesus began to talk more and more about commitment. Last but not least, Jesus began to talk more and more about the cross. You know, in the early part of Jesus' ministry, his message was that of the kingdom of God. Many people could relate to that. Some even have a misconception about the kind of kingdom of God that Jesus was supposed to usher in. They thought it was going to be a physical kingdom. But we all know that it's not. But towards the last 7 days of his life, Jesus began to talk more about his death and more about the cross. You see, friends, the cross, there's a song, if I remember correctly, a hymn that tells us the cross is a symbol of what? How many of you remember that Christian hymn? Symbol of suffering and shame. You see, the cross is not a prestigious emblem. The cross is not a branded item. The cross is not something prestigious that we would like to be associated with. Because the cross reminds us of the suffering that Jesus went through and a call on our life to pick up our cross, to deny ourselves and to follow him. Not many people want that, church. Not many people want the cross because the cross to them brings nothing but suffering and shame. But I have got good news for you. While it is true, earlier on, I remembered our worship leader said this, the cross also is a symbol of redemption, a symbol of hope, a symbol of life. Jesus said, take up your cross daily, deny yourself, follow me and follow me. And although sometimes the cross, many people do not want the cross because it represents to them the suffering. You know how Jesus was, Jesus was so convinced of this that he went to the cross for us to show us, you know, friends, to show us that he meant what he said, that he would sacrifice himself. See, not many people like the word sacrifice, because when we say sacrifice, it means we have to give up something. But here, the good news is this. Jesus is now asking us to give up our sin, give up our bad habits in replacement of his love, because he went to the cross for each and one of us today. Friends, that's why today is called Good Friday. Jesus began to talk more about the cross. The cross meant suffering, meant persecution. But today, friends, Jesus, the cross means also that we have redemption in him. We have life. We have hope. Now, I want you to know, Jesus' last words on the cross was this. On Good Friday, they took him and they crucified him. How many of you have seen the show, the movie, The Passion? I'm sure all of us have seen, right? And you know how you can see depicted the scenes and so on, but I want to say this something. You know, when they crucify someone, they crucify the person naked. But for that movie, it's for modesty's sake, they covered our Lord. But he was crucified naked. That's why the cross was called a symbol of suffering and shame. And when they crucified Jesus on the cross, friends, the last words that he said was this. He said, "It is finished." How many of you believe that the last words of the dying person is very important? Right? Dying, the last words of someone who is dying is very important. And I believe if we are at our dying bed, death bed, we will not try to tell a joke. But we will mean what we want to say, and you know, you keep it as straight to the point as it is. And Jesus kept it straight to the point. He says, "It is finish." Now, what did he mean by that? Did he mean that he was finished? That it was finished for him? No, church. What he meant was this, that every sacrifice, everything that needed to be done for the forgiveness of sin was done through him. It is finished. He went to the cross for you and me. No other sacrifice that will ever needed to be done in days to come or anything like that. Because Jesus became that sacrifice once and for all, and it is finished. Everything that needed to be done for the forgiveness of sin was done through Jesus Christ. That's why the cross is a symbol of hope this evening, church. Because it is finished. It is finished. We try to save ourselves, but we can't. We try to do everything possible, but we know we have failed time after time. But Jesus says, "Come to me." Because why? I have done it. It is finished. Through me, there is forgiveness. Friends, today, I don't know what you are struggling with in your life, but I know this for sure, that at the cross, it is finished. I want to just talk to you for a few moments before we observe the Holy Communion, we partake of the Holy Communion. Good Friday is good because Jesus went to the cross on our behalf. The Bible tells us that that sin demands punishment. And the Bible made it very clear that the punishment is death. And there was no way we could ever pay this price of sin, this penalty for sin. Because it meant that all of us had to die. But Jesus said, in the Bible tells us that God so loved the world that he sent his one and only begotten Son, that whosoever believe in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. Jesus made a way for us, for you and me, that we need not die on the cross. We need not pay for our sins, but accept what he has done for us. I pray that this Good Friday will be good for you because of Jesus. Because of Jesus. Friends, why did the cheering turn into jeering? I believe that because Jesus began to talk more and more about compassion. But how the kingdom of God how salvation is just not for a select few, but for everyone. For everyone, even those that are unlovable. Jesus began to talk more and more about commitment. Telling them you are not only that you are saved, but you are saved for a reason. You are saved to be a blessing. You are saved to share the good news. There is commitment involved. Last but not least, Jesus began to talk more about the cross. More and more about the cross. And that's why I believe the cheering stopped. And on Good Friday, he went to the cross. For the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross, his shame, and is now seated on the right hand of God. This evening, I don't know who you are, whether you're listening to me here right now in this place, in the sanctuary, or whether you're at home online. I want to give you an opportunity to respond before we partake of the Holy Communion. You know, Jesus loves you so much that he doesn't want you to be where you are. He doesn't want you to be lost in your sin. You know, sometimes we try our best to run our own lives, but you know, we know there's no way we can ever get out of it. We keep going around in circles. The habits that we have keep holding us back. I understand how all this feels. Before I came to know Jesus, you know, my life was in a shambles. But you know what, friends? The moment I gave my life to Jesus, you know, it brought me hope. Maybe there are some of us here that you are listening to me and you are saying to me, Pastor, I want this Jesus that you are talking about so that I can experience him, so that, you know what, this Friday can be a good Friday for me. If that's you, can I ask you to do one thing? Maybe you can indicate to us at the group chat and just say, Pastor, can you pray for me? Can you pray for me? Just indicate it in the group, in the chat box below. And if you are here, and I'm talking to you right now, my brothers and sisters here in this sanctuary, if that's you, and you're saying to me, Pastor, pray for me. I want this Jesus that you are talking about. You know, I am tired of running my own life. I'm asking that you will come, help me. I'm trapped in my sin, in my habit. I need you. And if that's you, and you are here in this hall, why don't you just raise your hands to me and say, Pastor, can you pray for me? Anybody here? Anybody here? You can raise your hands high so that I can see, so that I can just pray for you. Anybody? Yes? A brother here in front? Anybody else? Just saying, Pastor, help me. Pray for me. I want this Jesus that you're talking about. Anybody else here in this hall? I'm speaking to you. Maybe you need some time, but go ahead. Don't be shy. If that's you, why don't you just raise your hand so that I can pray for you? Anybody? Anybody else? If you're listening to me online again, please indicate it on the chat, live chat on a YouTube, and one of our pastors will get in touch with you. But what I would like to do now is this, pray for you. Can I ask that all of us just stand to our feet? Can we all just stand to our feet? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's just stand to our feet. Hallelujah. Can we just raise our hands to the Lord this evening, all of us here, all over this place? Just raise our hands to the Lord. Just, why don't we just thank Him for a while? Thank Him. And I'm going to pray. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. For those of you who have raised your hand and you have indicated that you say, Pastor, you know what? Pray for me. I want to know this Jesus that you're talking about. I want Him more and more in my life. Can you do this with me? Even as I pray, just repeat it. Repeat after me, okay? Just repeat after me. And mean it with all your heart, all right? Let's pray. Dear Jesus, thank you for today. I thank you, Lord, that I can come to know you. I ask right now that you will come into my life, that you come into my heart, that you will come into my situation. That God, that you will help me. That you will be the Lord and the Savior of my life. Father, today, I also ask that you will forgive me from all my sins. I ask, dear Father, make me your child, that today I can call you Abba Father. I thank you. I thank you for your love. I ask all this in Jesus' most precious name. Amen. Amen. Can we worship God in a song? Can the worship team can just lead us in a song? Let's worship God in a song before we partake of the Holy Communion. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, Rabba Kassandara Shandarayanda. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you, Jesus.
The same. Hallelujah. It's your blood that cleanses me.
Thank you, Lord.
It's your blood that cleanses me. It's your blood that gives me life. It's your blood that took my place in redeeming sacrifice. Washes me.
All of us to join us in partaking the Holy Communion this evening. The emblems are at your seat. For those of you who are at home, you can go ahead and serve the emblems. Shall we pray? Let's pray. Thank you, Jesus. Father, thank you for Good Friday. We thank you for what Jesus has done for us on the cross. How he went to the cross on our behalf and paid that price for us, a price, a debt that we could never pay, a debt that he never owed. Thank you, Jesus, for all that you have done for us. That today we can have salvation because it's your blood that cleanses us. Thank you for the forgiveness that is found at Calvary. Thank you for your obedience. Lord, thank you because it was for that joy that was set before you. You endured the cross, scorning its shame. And Father, now you are seated at the right hand of God. Thank you, Jesus, for all that you have done for us. Lord, I pray for my dear brothers and sisters here. Lord, as we partake of the emblems, may we remember all that you have done for us. For those of them who need a touch from you, God, meet them at the point of their need. Heal them, touch them. Father, I pray that you will continue, Lord God, Lord, to do all that you have said, and that God, that you will watch over each one of us and bless us. Thank you once again. In Jesus' mighty name, God, I ask and I pray. Amen. The Bible tells us, "For I received from the Lord what I also pass on to you." The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Shall we partake of the bread together? In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Shall we partake of the cup together? Let's just worship God in this last song as we close. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Oh,
bless you, and may the Lord keep you. May the Lord cause His face to shine upon you and give you rest. May the Lord your God continue to bless the work of your hands and cause you to prosper, even as your soul prospers this evening. Father, I thank you for my dear brothers and sisters that are gathered here, and for all of them who are watching online. Father, I pray, dear God, Lord, that your hand of protection will be upon each one of them, that no evil will come near them nor their dwelling place. Father, this evening, as a servant of the Most High God, I bless the people of God. May they go in the peace and the power and anointing of your Holy Spirit. I ask all this in Jesus' most precious name. And all God's people say, amen and amen. God bless you, church. See you on Sunday. Thank you for coming. God bless you. Testimony, why don't you just drop us a line, drop us an email. The email address is on the screen at this point of time. You can just do so and we will love to hear from you. And so thank you, church, for your cooperation. God bless you.
If you need all the information that you hear today, do log on to www.gtclang.com/updates. Your one stop for all your church needs. Also, if you are on Instagram or Facebook, do follow us at our handle at GT Clang. That's all the time we have today. God bless.